It's a very great pleasure to welcome Manuel De Landa, who I'm sure is kind of known to most of you as the author of War in the Age of Intelligent Machines. And he's actually going to talk about his new book, which is 1,000 Years of Nonlinear History, which very much unlike most, I don't know what you'd call them, kind of post-structuralist books, which seem to be restricted as histories to a kind of history of knowledge or a history of representation, a history of kind of signification, is very much an attempt to break out of that and to provide, as it were, a new way of characterizing elements of what I suppose used to be called material histories of the economy, of language, and of energy. Manuel De Landa teaches currently at Columbia, where he runs a course on the self-organization and urban history. I think he's not lectured here before, so it's a very great pleasure for all of us to welcome you today. Thank you very much.
Hi. Well, I teach at Columbia University. It's a seminar. It's at the architecture school. And so basically my job there is not only to try to teach the philosophy of Deleuze and Guattari to architects, but also to try to give architects a sense of context for their structures and their constructions, that it's a little more specific than simply talking about society in general or Western culture or one of those great abstractions that we are used to, capitalism and so on, and try to give them a sense of context that's much more texture, with much more detail, with a finer resolution, we might say. And of course, in this new view of history, when you try to get rid of this totality, these abstractions, like the capitalist system, what comes to replace this abstract, almost meaningless totalities is cities and urban centers in general. Of course, we also have nation states, larger sociopolitical structures, but as I make clear in the book, the space currently occupied by nation states was pre-organized by cities, particularly hierarchies of cities, such as the hierarchy of towns under Paris, or the hierarchy of towns under Vienna, or the hierarchy of towns under London or Madrid. It was those urban centers that pre-organized the space that would later become the nation state. So the main characters of my book are, in fact, then cities, or urban settlements in general. I divide this history, this urban history, into three separate chapters, each one going back to the year 1000 and going all the way back to the year 2000. So basically you read the same story three times, only every chapter deals with a different aspect of urbanity or a different aspect of city dynamics. The first one connects city growth to its sources in energy flow, whether the energy is agricultural energy, as I will mention in a moment for the first intensification of urban growth in Europe, or whether it's fossil fuels, or whether it's electricity drawn from hydropower. There's always, whenever you see a period in history in which urban birth rates go up the chart, and the birth of new urban settlements all of a sudden intensifies, you can always be sure that there's an intensified flow of energy that is responsible for that. you know, an intensified flow of energy that eventually results in increases in population, that eventually results in the densification of population that we call urban centers. So chapter one is basically an energetic history of Western cities, and touching, of course, on several aspects about economics, since obviously economics and money are, even though they are not directly energy-based, they are almost, we might call them catalysts for the circulation of energy to continue the intensification. That will become clear in a second. Chapter two is, as it were, the history of cities viewed from the point of view of microorganisms and plants. This goes with the spirit of the book of trying to do a non-anthropocentric view of history, something that I had already started in the war book. For all those of you that are familiar with the war book, you might remember that in the introduction I say that, well, it's a history of war and history of technology, and in the introduction I say that it'll be a robot historian from the future. You know, once human beings have disappeared and robots have taken over the planet and they develop their own historians. And so the entire book is told from the point of view of this robot in the future who, of course, will tell a different story than if he was told by a human, for instance. He privileges genealogies of artifacts like clockworks, motors, and networks. And so on, and the historian's heroes are things like the conoidal bullet and the rifle, and everything metallic appeals to the robot. So that literary device to kind of de-anthropomorphize history, to try to tell it from a non-human point of view, I used again in this book, and so chapter two is the turn of microorganisms and plants. The reason being that even though we as humans feel very proud of being at the top of the food chain, as every ecologist knows, being at the top of the food chain means being basically a decoration in an ecosystem, being the expendable part of an ecosystem, being the bottom of the food chain, being plants or the microorganisms in, for instance, the microorganisms that remineralize corpses, or the microorganisms that create the underground food chains called the rhizosphere, really are the basis for the architecture of an ecosystem, with large predators like ourselves being really mostly decorations. And so the microorganisms tell a very different story of cities, which I'll comment on in a second. Finally, there's another chapter in which I do linguistic history of cities, mostly the kind of dialects that were born in different urban settlements, the battles between different urban settlements to impose their dialect as the standard language of the region. And that gives you a view of the history of language is very different from the one that we get from semiotics and linguistics, in which language somehow is identified with this eternal dimension, this synchronic dimension that's outside of history, and it's a system that perhaps, if you are a Chomskyan, is stored in your brain, or if you are more of a Platonist, it exists somewhere as an essence in some Platonic haven. Here, what I do is basically a history of language as stuff, as linguistic material, the sonic stuff, the sounds of a language, the words of a language, and the grammatical constructions of a language are seen to be so many, almost as if we were charting the sedimentation of this linguistic materials within the walls of urban centers, and seeing how urban centers are this reservoirs of linguistic materials and how they allow languages to evolve and so on. So it's a very different view of cities. It's a more dynamic view of cities. And so I want to start now by making a few comments on chapter one. Chapter one is based a lot on recent history, the work of recent historians, particularly Fernand Braudel. for whom cities are very, very special entities. Braudel, for instance, calls cities accelerators of historical time, in the sense that, for instance, in the feudal period, you can see one history going at a particular speed in feudal lands, whereas in those towns that were growing in the middle of feudalism, history was being accelerated, and all kinds of things, for instance, money and banks, stock markets, and a variety of institutions that we now consider modern, and that many times we think of them as being born in the Renaissance, were actually born right in the middle of feudalism, which for Braudel illustrates the idea that there is not one flow of history, but several flows going at different speeds, and in this differential speeds of urban history versus rural history, and in urban different urban centers going at faster speeds than others, many of the secrets of the millennium can be found. So one of the questions that has become crucial for historians, and in which cities play a very important part of the answer, are questions that really were not asked before, when we used to think of Europe and the United States as somehow being destined to conquer the millennium. If you read a lot of history books, particularly those written 50 years ago and earlier, which are basically histories of Europe, there's a sense in which European civilization is kind of bound to win. You know, there's this notion of progress that's inherent to history, and of course it is European civilization that's going through that progress. So for those historians, the question, why not China, why not Islam, was almost meaningless. Well, why not? Because progress was not passing through those lands, it was passing through Europe. But of course, once you get rid of your Eurocentrism, and once you get rid of the notion of progress, or teleology, or destiny, the question, why not China and why not Islam, becomes extremely pertinent, considering that China and Islam were indeed more advanced civilizations all the way up to the 15th century, that China's markets were as powerful, China's economy as powerful and as complex as that of Europe up to the 18th century, that many of the technological innovations that allowed Europe to conquer and colonialize the world, such as the compass, gunpowder, movable type, paper money, come from China, and that many of the banking instruments, such as checks and double entry bookkeeping, that made the European economy so powerful, come indeed from Islam. So when we go back to the year 1000, the year zero in my book, you compare Europe to Islam or China, and Europe really looks like a third world of Islam, basically a bunch of pirate towns feeding from the leftovers left by Islam. And so if you can imagine traveling in time and going to the year 1000 and asking to bet who's going to win the millennium, the last entity you would have picked would have been Europe. I mean, Europe looked like a loser, basically, and history was going at a much faster speed somewhere else. Then all of a sudden, in about 500 years, Europe takes the lead and never loses again. And the explanation of that phenomenon has now become top priority for historians, particularly those that do not believe in destiny and do not believe in and are not Eurocentrist. And interestingly, urbanization, or a specific feature of urban centers, has turned out to be at least one of the main pieces of the puzzle. Now, to explain just exactly how this works, let me make a distinction between two types of urban center. That is very important, because of course China and Islam were heavily urbanized, and Baghdad was a huge metropolis, a huge capital, way before any city of Europe ever reached that type of population density. So it is not as if they lacked cities. So it is rather something about urban dynamics rather than cities per se that offers the explanation for Europe's getting ahead. So one distinction that has become very important, and this is one of the first things I teach my students at Columbia, so that they begin replacing this idea of society in general with very specific cities and types of cities, is the distinction between the landlocked capital, say Paris, Vienna, Madrid, Mexico City, and the maritime metropolis, such as Venice, Genoa, Lisbon, Amsterdam. There's, of course, combinations of the two. London can be seen as a combination of a political capital and a gateway to maritime routes, to maritime trade circuits, and so on. Now, the distinction is actually quite important. On one hand, your typical landlocked capital, and let's take Paris as our example, typically is more the ecology of institutions that the city houses, that is, the governmental institutions, markets, the schools, universities, and so on. Within that ecology, that complex, heterogeneous set of institutions housed within the city, centralized agencies, particularly governmental bureaucracies, tend to dominate the population. That's one of the characteristics of this landlocked capital. Another one is that, and this is something that a geographer in the 1930s, his name is Cristaller, was the first one to notice, just about every landlocked capital that you can think of is a large town at the top of a hierarchy of towns, so that the capital city will be surrounded by three or four smaller settlements, each one in turn with a ring of even smaller towns around them, with each one of those even smaller towns with its own kind of little solar system of smaller towns yet. Of course, given the fact that topography is not, you know, in Cristaller's theory, everything was perfectly hexagonal little patterns, which of course get never realized like that in reality, because the topography is never flat. There's all kinds of differences in climate and so on, and so the patterns get distorted, almost like bent or topologically. But the basic idea is correct. There is a hierarchy of cities. What determines the distances between cities is basically the speed of land transport, or the slowness, we might say, of land transport, if we're thinking right now a period before the railroads. And each one of the towns, as it increases in size, offers more and more services to the other towns around it. So that, for instance, the smallest towns of all would be simply market towns, and they would have perhaps a local government plus a large marketplace, which is this weekly gathering of people in the town. The next level of towns would have a more complicated institutional ecology within it, offering perhaps now a county jail, perhaps a school and a hospital. The next size of towns already perhaps has a royal institution with a representative from the king, a larger jail and a wider set of services. And of course the capital city, Paris in this case, has a much larger set of services. And so basically what you have here is a hierarchy arranged by complexity and numerousness, or the variety of services within each one of the settlements, and with a very dominant center in the middle, which is that big landlocked capital at the top. This arrangement works in such a way that people from the provinces, particularly the ones that will be intellectuals or will be architects or will be professionals that will not be able to find a job in their hometown, begin moving up the hierarchy moving first to the larger town near to them, and then eventually end up in the capital. So what you have is, over a couple of centuries, a brain drain, or all of the intelligent people from the bottom parts of the hierarchy begin moving up and end up in the capital city, much as today a lot of people would come to London from other places of England, or people that would come to New York. But what that means is that people from all the different provinces eventually become concentrated in the capital, and over a couple of centuries they begin distilling a more or less homogeneous culture for the entire region. I mean, that is, for instance, according to Braudel, how the more or less homogeneous French culture we know today, with its own identity and its own personality, was constructed piecemeal by this process of intellectuals from the provinces focusing and ending up in Paris. And so Paris and its hierarchy of towns organize a vast geographical region via these urban centers, and gave that region a certain cultural identity by forging or distilling a national culture within the capital. So the key word here is homogeneity. On one hand, the homogeneity of the culture they distill, they produce, and on the other hand, centralization. The fact that the ecologies of institutions within the cities are dominated by government bureaucracies, where a lot of planning gets done, and therefore centralized decision making takes place. On the other hand, we have these other cities I mentioned, maritime metropolises, which operate according to completely different dynamics. For one thing, the fact that they were maritime, and again, think that we're talking about right now the pre-railroad times. Before the railroad, the difference between sea and land transport, as far as speed, was enormous. Basically, sea transport was so much faster that Genoa was closer, as far as how fast the ideas develop in one city can reach the other, was closer to Genoa, to Lisbon, and even to Amsterdam than it was to Florence or Milan in its own backyard. This is just a matter of the different speeds of transport. And so that these cities began very early on, and I'm talking about as early on as the 13th century, creating not hierarchies, but networks of towns. Very early on in the history of Europe, a network of towns begin centered in Venice, but including many other cities in the Mediterranean and in the Atlantic and in the North Seas, began joining together with commercial links. Another one of the differences besides the speed of transport is that maritime cities have played traditionally the role of gateways to the outside. For instance, Venice was, for several centuries, when it was the center and dominant core of this network, was the gateway towards Islam. A lot of the ideas from Islam that eventually, for instance, double entry bookkeeping, enter Europe through Venice. Ideas from as far away as China also entered Europe, for instance, gunpowder, through Venice. And so Venice acted, rather than being like Paris, this center for the creation of a homogeneous culture that then gives a particular territory its historical identity. Venice almost did not have a historical identity in that sense, at least for a while. Later on, Venice does colonize its own terra firma, as they call it, its own piece of land, and it does become a republic, and it does become more like the other cities. But at the beginning, ports in the Mediterranean, beginning with Amalfi and going on to Venice and Genoa and so on, were rather heterogeneous cultural places, much as New York is today. New York is perhaps one of the best examples we have today of a maritime metropolis that does not really have an identity of its own. It simply is a repository for a large set of heterogeneous elements that come from all over the world, and it is basically a door or a gateway to other cultures where through which heterogeneous elements from other cultures can enter and mix and form a new blend. So when going back to the question, why not China, why not Islam, one of the answers that historians are now given is that even though China and Islam had gateway cities, Canton, for instance, continued to be a gateway to the outside for the longest time. Hong Kong is perhaps today playing that role. And so it's not as if they lacked those cities. Islam had also a gateway, maritime metropolises. They were dominated, the urban mix was dominated by landlocked, inward-oriented city, government cities, you know, for instance, like Baghdad or Peking. And a little anecdote here might actually make this point very clear. Before the Chinese set their capital in Peking, they actually had their capital in a gateway city, much like Britain has right now. So in other words, Nanking was both capital and gateway to the outside. It was a gateway towards Japan. It was a gateway to the cultures in Southeast Asia. And as the Portuguese, we're talking about the 1400s, as the Portuguese were beginning to plan their route around Africa, which eventually led them to India and to conquer all the markets of that area, China was sending huge ships to the Indian Ocean that had three or four times as many guns, twice as much tonnage, twice as much crew as anything that Vasco da Gama was ever able to have in that same area. The only thing the Chinese did not do was go around Africa. Had they done so, and they certainly had the capability, the military and navigational capability to do that, they would have discovered Europe, they would have colonized Europe, and perhaps today we would all be speaking Chinese. The important point about that is just to show you how iffy everything was in history, how little of a destiny Europe had as far as conquering the millennium, how different things could have been had the Chinese just not stopped those expeditions to the Indian Ocean. What happened basically was that as the Chinese were funding and sending these expeditions and therefore looking outward, that is being in a gateway mentality, they get invaded by the Mongols, which of course are peoples from the steppes and which of course have the most powerful war machine that humanity has invented prior to the creation of artillery. So you had to take them seriously. And they moved their capital from Nanking to Peking. They moved their capital inland. And almost as if by magic, the entire culture, the entire mentality of the elites becomes inward-oriented. They begin developing their own homogeneous culture. They begin developing their own urban hierarchies. They begin organizing space in the way in which Paris organized space, and not in the way in which Venice organized this open maritime spaces, which is a completely different way. And in a way, and this is what Braudel says, China basically lost its chance of becoming a world power. Although, of course, it kept its own all the way up to the Opium Wars. I mean, the British really had to play some really dirty tricks in order to be able to invade China, like making them first addicted to opium and then declaring war on them because they were not happy with the opium thing. So it's not as if China had lost strength. It was a very hard country to penetrate and to invade. And so we really did have to wait until the 19th century and railroads to be able to make inroads into that self-contained entity. But what China did lose was its outward orientation, and because the millennium ended up depending on who conquers the circuits of the Atlantic, who conquers the trade winds and the westerlies, which is these two gigantic conveyor belts that brought Columbus to America and back, and because the sea and the hydrosphere in general are such a complex non-linear dynamical system with so much energy in it, eventually the future would belong to those territories dominated by gateways and not by landlocked capitals. So that's one of the points I make in the book. I give all the evidence that I was able to gather to try to make my point a little more solid than I'm being able to present it right now. Another point that is equally important is to try to see what we might call the metabolism of cities. Cities are ecosystems, however simplified. People within the cities have to eat. They have to be able to breathe. As cities all the way up till the 19th century were not self-sufficient in neither in terms of food nor in terms of population. For instance, London in the 1600s needed about 5,000 rural migrants a year just to break even in population. The city as we know it, the city as a net producer of people, is a 19th century phenomenon. I mean, we had to wait for vaccines to come along, we had to wait for a certain amount of public hygiene programs such as drinkable water so that cholera would not spread. We had to wait for a variety of factors for the cities to become net producers of people. So for the longest of time, for the large part of the millennium, cities indeed depended on rural areas for food as well as for human flesh. And so it is not so strange, therefore, to think that any time the intensification of this flows, I mean, any time this flows that traverse cities from the outside became intensified to a great extent, something would actually happen to cities. And indeed, this is what happened. If you chart urban history in the West from the year 1000 to the year 2000, taking as your criteria of one of the, you know, time would be one of the axes, and if you take the other one of the axes in your chart to be birth rates of new cities, that is, periods of real urbanization, when new cities are being born at a very fast rate, there's two periods that immediately would strike your eye if you did this chart. In other words, the chart would peak twice. The first peak is between the years 1000 and 1300. That is smack right in the middle of feudalism. Most of the cities of Europe that are important today were either born in that period, Amsterdam and Venice, for instance, or if they existed because they had Roman origins like Paris or London or other cities, they grew enormously. Indeed, the intensity of urbanization that we witnessed between the 11th and 14th centuries is not matched again until the Industrial Revolution, when of course a new surge in the flow of energy begins traversing cities, in this case fossil fuel energy, coal in particular. So the very first energetic intensification, which dates to the 10th century, was due to an agricultural revolution. The horseshoe and the horse harness, which were for the first time put together and allowed the muscular energy of the horse to be tapped in an efficient way, were combined with a method of rotating, what is called triennial rotation of fields, so that you would plant a crop in a particular field, let other fields recover by laying them fallow, and then rotate the crops. When these elements that were created separately were finally meshed together, and it took a certain amount of time for this to happen, an enormous amount of energy, in this case of food, began flowing through Europe. If we think that all that this food is solar energy that has been converted into sugars by photosynthesis. Basically, what we have here is an intensification of the flow of solar energy through cities. Eventually, the Industrial Revolution, based as it was on coal, is again solar energy, because fossil fuels are just the bodies of animals and plants that have become remineralized by bacteria in certain conditions, but that originally were also just kind of solar energy captured into flesh. And so we have two great intensifications in the history of Europe that resulted in this incredible amount of urban births. And again, since, well, let me just go back to the first intensification. One of the main points I try to make in the book, by trying to make cities the main characters, is that some of the ways in which we tend to periodize history, and that we have inherited from classical thinkers like Karl Marx and others, for instance, the most common one, which is feudalism, capitalism, and socialism, or feudalism, capitalism, and the information age, you know, this supposedly homogeneous ages through which humanity passes through, have become an obstacle, almost a caricature, that it is distorting our view of history. One of the very interesting things about the period between the year 1000 and the year 1300 is that you see cities mushrooming all over Europe, most of them with well-defined identities, in the sense that all of them had a protective wall around them, with exceptions of certain cities in the Netherlands that had large expanses of water to serve as defenses, and some cities in England that also had water as part of their defense. Most of the most medieval towns were walled towns, and therefore it was very easy to define where the city starts and where it ends. I mean, it was almost as if humanity had mineralized in those years and surrounded itself with this kind of mineral exoskeleton, of which the outer wall of the city was just the most manifest sign. Within those cities, all those urban centers with walled urban centers, even though they were right in the middle of a feudal age, they became kind of temporary autonomous zones from feudalism in the following sense. The town as a whole, of course, the land that the town occupied was owned by some feudal landlord, whether it was a bishop or a king. But the town as a whole, as a corporation, paid dues and rents to the bishop or the king, but the individual citizens of the town did not have any allegiance to the king or the bishop. Therefore, if a peasant that was a serf and belonged to some feudal lord escaped and went into the town and was accepted into the town as a citizen after 1 or 2 years of residence, he immediately became free, in a sense. Of course, he would immediately get caught into other hierarchies. Now, you know, commercial hierarchies, so governmental hierarchies within the city, but at least he had broken free from the feudal regime. So cities indeed became these islands of privilege, these islands where modernity could be invented, these islands where most of our modern institutions, for instance, most of the basic laws that make our contract law for commercial transactions, our kind of the synthesis of the Roman type of state and the church type of state was finally put together in a harmonious whole. Many of the things that eventually characterized the personality and essence of Europe were created in these temporary autonomous zones. So what we have here, the vision I want to project, is one in which a particular territory, a particular expanse of land on the planet becomes traversed by an intense flow of energy, giving rise to these mineralized creatures. which immediately become islands of privilege against feudal lords, where all those restrictions, all those constraints can be relaxed, and where a new, for instance, new classes, such as the new middle classes, can be invented, where new cultural ideas and new concepts could be created. And most importantly, thanks to this division of labor between gateways and capitals, where these dynamics could be kept continuing. Because as I said, China and Islam also had their own intensifications and their own urbanizations, but there everything came to a stop at some point, and governmental cities came to dominate and impose a more or less homogeneous culture over the entire expanse of the territory. It is only in Europe that even though it was attempted three times during the Habsburg Empire, during Napoleon and during Hitler's time, there was an attempt to unify the entire territory and make it into a replica of China or Islam. They did not succeed, and so Europe remained this heterogeneous combination of different types of cities, which eventually is what allow the creativity to continue. How am I doing time-wise? Quarter to six? Oh, do I have another 10 minutes or something? Well, that is a brief summary of what Chapter 1 is about. Of course, in Chapter 1, I try to give more than just this, because the whole idea is to replace Karl Marx's thinking in terms of feudalism, capitalism, and socialism, and to try to replace it with a much more heterogeneous view of history, where indeed the supposedly homogeneous ages don't really exist, and what we have is the coexistence of histories going at different speeds, and of towns acting as accelerators of historical time. But precisely because I have to replace Karl Marx being the genius he is, has to be replaced with all kinds of detailed economic ideas, and that is what actually forms the main body of Chapter 1. Chapter 2, and this will be a little faster, deals with cities as ecosystems. And so it begins with, again, Europe in the year 1000, which is mostly a temperate forest as an ecosystem. A temperate forest which in about 300 years gets mostly destroyed by this urbanization, so that urbanization has a price. Prior to the Black Death, prior to the 15th century epidemic that killed a third or a four or a half of the European population, And therefore made everything sort of like a start again type of thing. Prior to the Black Plague, Europe was already confronting its first ecological crisis due to intense deforestation, a complete lack of regard for topsoil, planting on slanted hills, which of course makes the rain, you know, once you take the trees off and the roots which are making the soil stay there, once you deforest, particularly if you do it carelessly, the soil gets washed away. And so in the early 1300s, 1315, even though famines have been part of the world history forever, global famines were not, and Europe faces its first full-fledged ecological crisis. 1315 is a date of the first global famine in Europe. So that by the time the Black Plague hit, it was much easier for the germs to spread from one undernourished mass to another undernourished mass. In other words, the plague came later. Europe was paying the price that, of course, we are today confronting a similar ecological crisis. And one of the things that I think is interesting about the book is to remind us that we're not the first ones to do this, that we've made similar mistakes in the past. When I treat cities as ecosystems, one of the first things that is important to notice is that they replace what's a temperate forest, which is a natural ecosystem. A natural ecosystem typically is described as a food web, as opposed to a food pyramid. It's really a decentralized food web, because even though we tend to think of it as plants, herbivores, and carnivores, that really is not the way an ecosystem works. There's much more side chains and horizontal connections and so on. And so what urbanization does, basically, is to replace a complex food web or a food network with a food pyramid, in which one species, in this case humanity, is at the top. And the way in which we make all the flows in ecology, the stuff that travels through food webs, the flesh basically, the flesh of vegetables and the flesh of herbivores and carnivores, is called biomass. So this, what cities involve is to a way of converting a flow of biomass that's decentralized and network-wise into a flow that has made into a pyramid, where all the flows now are focused on humanity at the top. And so what humans have done traditionally to focus biomass on them is to use domesticated species as kind of biomass converters. Cows and animals like them basically eat parts of plants that we cannot digest, cellulose, for instance, and transform it into flesh and milk that we can eat. So we can think of cows as if they were this kind of biomass transformers that get kind of screwed at the back end of the farm, so to speak, and then all the unedible biomass flows through them, they convert it into flesh, and then we eat them. And pigs are even more efficient biomass converters. They transform something like 50% of what they eat into flesh. Unfortunately, pigs eat a lot of the stuff that we also eat, so they are actually more useful as temporary storage devices. So we can think of pigs as biomass memory chips. Through the use of domesticated animals, and you can see that when Europeans colonized the rest of the world, they colonized the world as an extended family. They move with their animals with them, because it's the only way they can move to other parts of the world and focus flows of biomass on this food pyramid. But for the same reason, the coexistence within these dense urban centers of people and animals made cities into what we might call epidemiological laboratories. That is, laboratories to create new diseases. That is, the places where something like cowpox could be transformed into smallpox, chickenpox into smallpox. We have something like most of our diseases, we have them in common with dogs, cows, pigs, and chickens, because we are all one happy family, as far as the microbes can tell. And they develop what is called, you know, what historians now call specifically urban diseases. A specifically urban disease is an epidemic disease that, when unleashed in a rural open space, simply burns itself out as it kills its human fuel. But that, if allowed to traverse an urban center after several waves of this epidemic, the survivors are, of course, now immunized, and the diseases become childhood diseases. They lose some of their virulence, some of their potency, some of their damaging potential. They still exist in the bodies of the inhabitants of the cities, since they are using those bodies as part of their habitat. And now, as long as we keep giving them a fresh supply of human flesh every year, babies, basically, they become childhood diseases. And so smallpox and measles, which are perhaps the two most popular childhood diseases, are like that. They have changed from a relationship to humanity in terms of an epidemic, a runaway explosive state, to what is called an endemic state, which is a stable state. But for the same reason, they become specifically urban diseases. And so urban centers manufacture these germs and implant them in the bloodstream of their inhabitants as if they were basically biological weapons. When Spaniards conquered Mexico, for instance, I come from Mexico, and to me it was always a puzzle, how is it that 30 million Aztecs that ate people for breakfast, and therefore were like really, then, you know, were warriors, could have been conquered by 30 or 40 pirates with muskets that took forever to load. You know, wait, just hold it. I mean, you couldn't possibly kill one Aztec at one of those muskets. I mean, the psychological impact must have been great, and when they saw horses, they probably also freaked out. But by the time they saw their arrows pierced through horse flesh and through the armor, that psychological effect probably went away. Historians today believe, because the population of Mexico went from 30 million to 3 million in about 50 years, it's just impossible to kill that many people unless you unleashed on them an epidemic, which is precisely what they did. Urban Europe, epidemiologically scarred people came and confronted, which was basically a virgin population, at least virgin relative to those diseases. I think America did fight back by sending syphilis. too late. And so the point here being that when Europe created replicas of itself across the Atlantic, it was not cultural replicas of itself, it was ecological replicas of itself. For instance, in many areas of temperate, there's five areas of the world, the temperate areas of Canada, the United States, Argentina, New Zealand, and Australia, which are ecologically or basically neo-Europes. All the way to weeds, all the way to these humble weeds, you cannot find a local weed in New York City that is from New York. All the weeds are from Europe. They came in the boots of the sailors and in wooden planks and so on. They fought their own colonization wars. The weeds in America were not used to heavy grazing and being stepped on by cows and cattle and so on. And so they would react bad to those selection pressures, while the weeds from Europe were already perfectly adapted to that. And so they began colonizing their own fronts. The same thing with, say, trees like orange and peach trees that acquire weedy behavior and began spreading on their own. Indians on the west coast of the United States decades before they saw a pale face, they had already seen the ecological changes in their ecosystems, because they would see new seeds flowing in the rivers or new trees all of a sudden appearing, or wild horses coming from Mexico that had become feral, that had become wild again, and were now moving upwards in following their own migration patterns. So what chapter two, and I'm not really going to explain to you chapter three, that way you get to have a surprise when you read the book. What chapter two then tries to do is to try to describe cities as simplified ecosystems, try to find the kind of fleshy machinery, pigs and cows and so on, that allow this transformation to take place, and then to see the colonization of the world as being basically an urbanization, but performed not only by Europeans, but Europeans and their extended families. I probably should stop here and we have some time for questions. Thank you very much.
I'd like to ask a little bit about the colonization of areas you haven't mentioned. For instance, Eastern and South Africa, Southern Africa, where you have countries there that were, or nation states there, that are now show the remnants of colonization from different European nations. Mozambique from Portugal, and Zimbabwe, what is now Zimbabwe from the UK. How you would describe those? Would you suggest these are some sort of singularities of energy flow? Whether you could mention something about the difference between that colonization process and the colonization of North America?
Well, rather, what I would say is that that's an example of Europeans moving into an ecosystem that was not a replica of their own. and that therefore their own weeds and their own plants could not do a lot of the work they did for them in the Neo-Europes. If you, for instance, go to India, you still see the highlands as being, you know, already kind of colonized ecologically by Europe. You see oak trees and so on. And the moment you go into the lowlands, you see the natural vegetation. So that there were indeed areas of the world that were just not ecologically receptive to that type of easy colonization. So that Europeans had to indeed compromise with the locals, in many cases mix with the locals. I mean, that is indeed what happened in Mexico City. We have, you know, in there the Spaniards actually blended with the locals and blended some elements of local culture with some elements of their own culture, and they did not really create ecological replicas of Europe. So I would say that that would be the same case what you're talking about.
I'd like to ask you a question about companies. Now, you began by contrasting mobile cities with, let's say, bureaucratic cities. But what interests me is the tendency for mercantile agencies, namely companies, to become themselves bureaucratic centers, and then for the choice of headquarters to, in a sense, tip the system away from the model that you've described. And in particular, the location of corporate headquarters becomes a very important factor then in the prosperity, in the relative prosperity of provincial cities and capital cities. Because for instance, Glasgow, let's say, in 1920, I believe 80% of people working in Glasgow worked for Glasgow companies. By the 1970s, it was down to 20%, because companies had shifted their headquarters, or the local companies had closed, or mergers and so on. Now, it seems to me that the company as an agency hasn't quite sort of been studied, despite the everybody studies capitalism, as it were, but companies seem to be something like the sort of biological phenomena that you're describing, and which have a behavior pattern that perhaps might fall within your mode of description.
Oh, absolutely. Well, I mean, they are one of the members of this institutional ecologies I was talking about before that inhabit cities. As you know, the corporate form, as a legal form, you know, the idea that a particular body, whether it's a university or whether it's a bank, that can be represented legally as a person in a court of law is unique to the West. That's one of the inventions of the Middle Ages, as a matter of fact, one of the legal inventions of the Middle Ages. But just going back to the point that you're saying, one of the very interesting points that Braudel makes, and that really for the first time goes against both Marx and Adam Smith as far as how we see, you know, because our options seem to be whether we regard capitalism as evil or whether we regard the invisible hand of capitalism as being good. What Braudel does is to break completely with that tradition and say all the way back to Florence in the 14th century, for instance, you can see within this ecology of institutions, with this all these different institutions inhabiting cities, you can see small firms they are like hundreds of them, or at least tens of them, and therefore they compete against each other, but in a more or less anonymous way, there being so many of them. And then you have large companies, large corporations, the ancestors of the multinational corporations of today, which he very appropriately calls anti-markets, to signal the fact that despite the fact that they were commercial entities, and perhaps the best example are the companies of India that the British had, the Dutch had, the Spanish had, the French had, and which were almost like states within the state, and held. And they had their own police, they had their own schools, they had their own, you know, they were like mini states, much as many multinational corporations today are mini states. They are not really market entities anymore. So what Braudel says is, all the way back to the beginning, all the way back to the 13th and 14th centuries, one can see a complete difference in dynamics between wholesale and retail. Retail is the small person that goes to the town and takes the price that's going. wholesaler is someone who has a huge warehouse, is capable of storing grain, waiting for the prices to go up, or even dump grain on the market to lower them artificially so that he can. So there's something about size and large scale and particularly hierarchical managerial structure of this anti-market institutions that makes them capable of manipulating demand and supply. Now what Braudel says, and I think this is a very important thing, is you know, he denies that there is such a thing as the capitalist system, which to me is almost an outrageous claim, you might say, because you point to the outside and say, well, that is capitalism. But what he really means to say is not to deny that there's economic power, that there has been economic exploitation of workers, that there has been the killing of towns by large corporations, that when they close a plant or they move away from a town, they kill the city. He's not trying to deny that. What he's trying to say is there's always, as far back as the 12th century, a distinction between decentralized market economies, where hundreds of small producers and consumers interact, and these large organizations, these proto-multinational corporations, these ancestors of today's mega companies that have always existed, have always been there, and have always been what we would identify with capitalism. To me, this is a very important distinction because for the entire century, we've been confronted with this option between socialism, let's give all the power to the government will plan the economy, and capitalism, which is supposed to be this invisible hand, decentralized dynamics. But that indeed now, if we look at history, the choice was never a real choice. It was a choice between governmental hierarchies and commercial hierarchies. Whereas indeed, there is a third choice, an economy based on regional economies of small businesses. Yesterday at the ICA talk, I gave an example of the Emilia-Romagna region in Italy, just about 20,000 small businesses which they're dedicated to ceramics and textile design, but that are so small and so numerous, they cannot leave the region and kill it. Unlike General Motors, that in the moment they want to, they close a plant and they kill a town. So from the point of view of the state today, the states should begin to realize that now they are in competition with multinational corporations, and multinational corporations are indeed endangering the integrity of the nation state, and that states should indeed begin promoting this third way, this middle way between socialism and large business and big business, which is these regional economies for which we have a lot of historical precedents once we get rid of these caricatures of periodizing history a la Marx, and we begin looking for economic phenomena in more detail.
Could I kind of just ask a question about, like, I mean, you talk about the Marxist and, like, non-Marxist accounts of why, for example, capitalism kind of developed in the West and not in Islam, not in China. It seems to me that frequently, in a way, Marxism is just the same as other kind of social sciences in its account of the origins of capitalism, in that, in a sense, kind of what it says is, well, capitalism came about because of the growth of markets, whatever, in the kind of feudal period. And if you ask in turn, well, what's that based on? You know, like people like Perry Anderson will go back to, well, it's really because in the end, kind of the whole thing was given a kind of rational legal structure in antiquity. So you know, it's not about the economy as such, it's about a legal framework. But really, in a way, what it all boils down to is an assertion from Marx and Weber and everyone that there is something peculiarly expansionist about the West which isn't there in China or in Islam. It seems to me that in some sense, you know, your argument cuts across that because it removes all those kind of expansionist kind of arguments or not just by saying, well, you know, it happened in a completely unintentional way.
Well, you're right, but at the same time, the insights of this very, very clever Marxist you just mentioned need to be taken into account, because it is true that as far, for instance, there's a new notion in economics called transaction costs, which are certain costs that are never taken into account, for instance, the costs of drawing a contract, the cost of enforcing a contract, The Japanese, for instance, don't want to invest in Mexico today because they know the court system is so Kafkian that you need to be an insider in order to be able, if you want to, for instance, start a franchise of McDonald's or start, the cost of enforcing the contract are so high in the sense that there's all these hidden knowledges you must know the judge and how to grease them and so on. So transaction costs are very high in Mexico. One of the reasons why Europe took off before the Renaissance was precisely because they managed to keep transaction costs down, and that was due to this legal framework you're talking about. So there's room for both. The expansionist urge, I would also accept that there's something to it, but I would rather frame it in terms of this gateway cities. You know, when the number of when in the mixture of urban centers, gateways predominate, you have this outward orientation that has very little to do with the European spirit or something unique to Europeans, and it has more to do with an urban dynamics that could have happened in China or Islam. Indeed, if China had not changed its capital to a landlocked capital, it may have indeed profited much more from its own gateways instead of letting them die. So that this expansionism, I agree that it existed, but what I don't agree is that it should be explained in terms of some peculiar trait of European culture.
Where does religion come in? Because do you think religion has a place at its all in that expansion? Do you think that it isn't purely that?
Well, I mean, you remember that Max Weber had this thesis that a lot of people still believe, that there's a certain spirit of thrift going with Protestantism that explains why the north part of Europe was the one that became the center of capitalism in the 18th and 19th centuries and so on. So there may be a role for ideas. And let me just, rather than answering your question directly, because I'm not a religious expert, what I would just want to put it in perspective. The way I see things, what Braudel does and what I try to do in my book is to replace notions like society, which is a totality, with, for instance, Marx begins with the capitalist system, but also non-Marxist sociologists like Durkheim or Parsons begin with society as a whole because they think it's a kind of organism where all the different elements or different institutions fit together and everything has a function. The way I see it, one has to start, instead of starting with the whole, which doesn't really exist as far as I can tell, we should start at the bottom and try to explain how each one of these wholes, how each one of these cities was born from an actual, from practices of individuals, from actual interactions between individual human beings, but also from the actual interactions between individual institutions, so that the picture would go like that. You have a dynamics of people making decisions, not rationally, because we don't really, you know, I don't believe in rationality as some kind of magic faculty in the brain, but we certainly are problem solvers and we can get around pretty well with our intelligence and our limited or bounded rationality. So you have you have a multiplicity of individual human beings as decision makers, making decisions, making choices, acting on those choices. From the interactions between individuals, institutions emerge. For instance, from the interactions between certain rich merchants in Venice, the stock market of Venice was born. At first, the merchants dealt with each other via informal rules, but when those rules become formalized and the stock exchange acquires a building, sort of like mineralizes, so to speak, it becomes a new entity, an entity that outlived its founders and has outlived many generations of Venetians. And the same thing for the stock markets of every city. So from the practices of individuals, something comes out. But that once it comes out, it's an entity of its own. From the interactions between institutions, cities emerge. And so what Braudel would say is history is really histories. We should always speak in the plural because we have all these parallel worlds, you know, the dynamics of individual human beings, the dynamics of institutions, the dynamics of cities, the dynamics of systems of cities, all of them having their own history, except at different time scales. The dynamics of cities happen so slowly that to us they are almost fixed. The dynamics of institutions happen a little faster, but yet we still perceive them as almost eternal entities sometimes, because relative to our own time scales, they last so much longer. But that indeed everything is changing, only at different speeds. And so to answer your question about religion, religion or other types of worldviews, belief systems, certainly influence the decisions and the day-to-day actions of these individuals, and in many times they might become the core aspect of the personality of a particular institution, but that's it. Worldviews affect these dynamics only at certain levels and in certain ways, and they are not the last word. There are many things that happen, for instance, these interactions between gateways and capitals, that have very little to do with worldviews. And that indeed, if I was right at the beginning by saying that capitals distill worldviews by doing a brain drain and homogenizing a culture, then indeed cities produce cultures rather than the other way around.
This is going to have to be the last question with a short answer.
Absolutely. No, you're right. I mean, the only reason I did it is to kind of simplify the presentation in a more detailed presentation. I would have to acknowledge the heterogeneity of Islam, and indeed, everything is heterogeneous. And whenever we find something that's homogeneous, that is what needs explanation. You know, when we find that China did indeed develop a more or less homogeneous culture, we need to go in there and explain homogeneity, because heterogeneity is in a way what's given. Everything is heterogeneous. Homogeneity is what's artificial, so we always need a special explanation. So you're absolutely right that I shouldn't really talk about Islam in general, except for simplicity's sake.
Okay, well, we're going to have to draw it to a conclusion. On your behalf, I'd like to thank Manuel De Landa very much.